Hi friends, welcome to our YouTube channel Naraj Academy. The main aim of this lecture is to discuss about the ISRO 2017 W solutions in a very detailed manner. And if you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel and don't forget to press the bell icon button. So whenever you upload a new video, the direct notifications comes to mobile. If any improvements needed in our lectures, then please do comment in the comment section. We will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. So why do waste more time? So let's get started. So now we are going to solve the 21st question. See the question here. A power MOSFET is a. So a power MOSFET is a. Option A, voltage control device. Option B, current control device. And option C, frequency control device. And option D, none of the above. So out of the four options, option A, it is a voltage control device. And now let us discuss something more about this MOSFET. So now we'll discuss some of the important facts of a MOSFET. So MOSFET, the full form of the MOSFET is metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. See, the full form of MOSFET is metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. And basically it is called as a workhorse of the electronic industry. Means here, workhorse of electronic industry means these, the MOSFET switches are being produced in a huge number of quantity when compared to remaining other switches like BJT and FET. If you compare all those things, then the MOSFET is going to manufacture in a huge amount of quantity when compared to remaining all other semiconductor switches. So because of that reason, we say MOSFET is a workhorse of electronic industry. And also it has a very faster switching speed and also very small size, and it is very cheaper than compared to BJT, and also it consumes less amount of power when compared to BJT. These are the important advantages of MOSFET when compared to BJT. It has very fast switching speed, and also it consumes less amount of power, and it has very small amount of size, and also it is very cheaper when compared to BJT. These are the important points when compared to the BJT. So because of all these reasons, we are going to use MOSFET in a huge number of applications when compared to BJT. And one more important point is here, we are going to compare the difference between the MOSFET and also the BJT right now. So now here, this is a circuit diagram, or we can say this is the symbol of a N-channel MOSFET, and this is the symbol of a P-channel MOSFET. Here the arrow is inside for a N-channel MOSFET and the arrow is outside for a P-channel MOSFET. It is going to have three terminals, gate, drain and source. Here also gate, drain and source. This MOSFET switch is used for the on and off, and also it is used in the amplifier applications. So MOSFET can be used whether for on of the switch and also off, and also for the amplifiers also we are going to use this MOSFET. And here, whenever the gate to source voltage is greater than threshold voltage, then only the circuit is on. And if the gate to source voltage is less than the threshold voltage, we can say the circuit is off condition. So the on and off of a circuit is going to depend upon only the voltage. So that is the reason we are going to say it is a voltage control device, because on and off of the circuit is going to depend purely on the gate to source voltage. So because of this reason, we say it is a control on the voltage. It is a voltage control switch. Now we will discuss some of the important difference between a MOSFET and a BJT. So for a MOSFET, it has a lower switching losses. So MOSFET will have lower switching losses, whereas the BJT has higher switching losses. And also the on state resistance of the MOSFET is more. So whenever the on state resistance is more, its losses, means we can say the conduction losses are also more. But for a BJT, the on state resistance is very less, and also we can say so the conduction losses are very less for a BJT when compared to MOSFET. And basically the MOSFET is a voltage control device. So on and off of the MOSFET is going to depend upon the gate to source voltage. So we can say it is a voltage control device, whereas a BJT is a current control device. So the on and off operation of a BJT is going to purely depend upon the base current. So because of that, we can say it is a current control device. And now here, MOSFET is a positive temperature coefficient device. So here, whenever the temperature is increases, its resistance also increases. So we can say it is a positive temperature coefficient for resistance. As the temperature increases, so we can say its resistance is also increases. This, so MOSFET is a positive temperature coefficient for resistance. So because of this, we can say the parallel operation is possible for MOSFET. So because of this important thing, which is it's a positive temperature coefficient. So because of this positive temperature coefficient for resistance, so we can easily operate the MOSFET in a parallel operation. Suppose here these are the MOSFET 1 and this is the MOSFET 2. Suppose now I want to operate in parallel. So I want to operate in parallel. Suppose here the current is I1 and the current is I2. Suppose let me assume the current is increased. Suppose the current is increased due to some sudden changes. As the current increases, we can say the current through M1 and also M2 is going to increase. As these are increases, we can say the temperature is going to increase. As the temperature increases, it is a positive temperature coefficient. See, as the temperature increases, its resistance also increases because it is a positive temperature coefficient. So therefore, as the resistance increases, we can say that the current is going to get decrease. So whatever the current is increase, now the same current is going to decrease. So we can say the current is constant. So now these two MOSFETs can carry the current in an equal manner. So this is the reason we can say parallel operation is possible only for MOSFET. Now let us see about the BJT. So BJT is a negative temperature coefficient for resistance. Means as the temperature increases, its resistance decreases. Or we can say as the temperature decreases, its resistance will increase. So now because of this factor, we can say if you want to make a parallel operation to possible, then we have to connect an extra resistance in order to limit the current. So if you want to make a parallel operation, we need to connect a current limiting resistor. So generally, if you keep any two BJTs, parallel operation is not possible. But if you want to make a parallel operation, then definitely you have to add an extra resistance in parallel with this BJT. Suppose this is a BJT1 and this is BJT2. Suppose this is a current I and this is the current sharing is I1 and I2. Suppose I am going to assume due to certain variations the current I is increased. So therefore I1 and I2 also going to increase. As the current increases through this BJT, its temperature will increase. As the temperature increases, its resistance will decrease because it is a negative resistance. It is a negative temperature coefficient for resistance. As temperature increases, resistance must decrease. So we can say as the resistance is decreases, so we can say the current will increase. So therefore we can conclude that here the current is increased, again the current is increased. So therefore current goes on increases. So because of this reason, this BJTs may get damaged. So because of this reason, we have to connect an extra current limiting resistor. So R1 and here R2. But this is not at all. Don't have to add the current limiting resistors for MOSFET. But here compulsory for BJT, you have to add the current limiting resistors if you want to operate a BJT in parallel. And one more thing is here MOSFET, here there is no secondary breakdown is possible for MOSFET because it is a positive temperature coefficient for resistance. Whereas yes, secondary breakdown is possible for BJT because as the current is increases, then the temperature increases, so resistance decreases and further current may increase. So if you operate the BJTs without current limiting resistance, the current will increase. As the current will increases in a BJT, for a small amount of heat the current will be very high. So therefore we can say the BJT will get very amount of heated, so hot spots are going to occur on the BJT, then the BJT is going to get damaged. So because of this reason, we can say secondary breakdown is possible for the BJT if you are not going to connect any current limiting resistor. If you are not going to connect any current limiting resistor, then definitely secondary breakdown is going to possible for BJT. So now we are going to solve that 22nd question. See the question here. Accuracy is defined as, so this question belongs to measurements. So in this question, they're asking what is the definition of an accuracy. So out of the four options, option B is the correct solution of this question, which is closeness with which an instrument reading approaches to the true value of the quantity being measured. So let's discuss something more about this one. So now we'll discuss some of the important facts of this accuracy. So basically, accuracy is called as a closeness of the measured value to a true value, then we say it is a accuracy. So closeness of measured value to the true value is called as a accuracy. Suppose there is a true value of 2 ampere. So I am going to measure this 2 ampere with the help of 5 instruments. So with the help of same instrument, I got the reading for 2 amperes at different time intervals, which is the 1.6 ampere, 1.7 ampere, 1.7 ampere and 1.8 ampere and 1.9 ampere. So out of all these things, the value which is very closer to 2 ampere is 1.9. So we can say accuracy is 1.9. precision means the value which is repeating more number of times in a given data. So from this, all this data, the number which is repeating more number of times is 1.7. So therefore we can say precision is equal to 1.7. Similarly, I want to measure a current of 2 ampere with the help of same instrument at different time intervals. I got which is 1.9 ampere, 1.9 ampere, 1.9 ampere and 1.7 and 1.8. So out of all these things, the value which is very closer to true value is called as accuracy. So therefore out of these, the very accurate reading is 1.9. And also, if you want to know what is the precision, so we can say the value which is repeating more number of times. So from all these things, 1.9 is repeating 3 times, so we can say the precision is 1.9. So now we can confirm that here an accurate instrument can be very precise. An accurate instrument can be a precise, but a precise instrument may not be an accurate. So we can say that accuracy may confirm say precision, but a precision does not confirm say accuracy. So therefore, accuracy may confirm it is a precision, but a precision may not confirm it is a accuracy. This is a very important relation between a accuracy and a precision. So accuracy means the value, the closeness of measured value to a true value is called as an accuracy, and precision indicates the value which is repeating more number of times in a given set of data is said to be a precision. So always an accuracy can confirm a precision, but a precision does not confirm an accuracy. So now we are going to solve the 23rd question. See the question here. If 3 amplifiers having the same bandwidth are cascaded, then the bandwidth of the resulting amplifier will be. So in this question, they are given 3 amplifiers of same bandwidth are going to cascade. Now they are asking what is the overall bandwidth of the amplifier they are asking. So what are the 4 options? Option B, it will be worse than that of the each stage. It will be very much worse than that of each stage. Now we'll discuss why option B is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. So now here there are 3 amplifiers, they are going to connect in a cascade fashion. So cascade means the output of one is going to given as the input for the another one. So amplifier 1 is going to have a gain of A1 and the bandwidth of B1, and amplifier 2 is going to have a gain of A2 and bandwidth of B2, and amplifier 3 is going to have a gain of A3 and bandwidth of B3. So if you are going to connect in a cascade fashion, then for the overall amplifier it is going to have the gain and bandwidth, the product of gain and bandwidth should be constant for each and everyone. So therefore overall amplifier also is going to have gain and bandwidth product must be equal to constant. So here the equivalent amplifier is going to have a gain which is the product of individual gains. So therefore net gain is equal to product of individual gains, which is A1 A2 A3 into overall bandwidth of the amplifier is equal to constant. So here the gain is increased, so A1 A2 A3, it is the product, so therefore the gain is increased. So if one is parameter is going to increase, then the other parameter should be decreased, then only their product will be equal to constant. So therefore now we can say as the gain of the net amplifier is increased, so therefore its bandwidth should be decreased, then only its product will be equal to constant. So whatever the bandwidth of the net amplifier which is lesser than the minimum of the individual bandwidths of the amplifiers, so therefore whatever the bandwidth of the net amplifier we are going to get, it will be lesser than the minimum of the B1, B2, B3. So we can say the bandwidth of the net amplifier is the very least. So we can say simply it is very worse, means very least value when compared to minimum of the individual amplifier. So because of this reason we say it is a worse bandwidth. So as the gain is increased, so if bandwidth must be decreased, then only the product will be equal to constant. So now we are going to solve the 24th question. See the question here. The core of a moving iron instrument is made up of permalloy 2. So here the core of a moving iron instrument is made of permalloy. Because of for what reason we are going to make the core by permalloy? So what are the 4 options? Option A, increase the sensitivity. So to increase the sensitivity, we are going to make the core with the help of permalloy in a moving iron. And now we'll discuss something more about this one. So now here, this is a block diagram of a MI basic measuring instrument. So this is a source and this is a edge core. This core is going to be made of permalloy, and also here this is a coil which is going to wound here. And now here this is a thing on which, this is a spindle on which we are going to keep a pointer, and there are 2 springs, and also there is a soft iron disc. And here if you want to control the damping of this one, we are going to use the air damping. So because of this, whenever I have given a source, this coil is going to produce a magnetic field. So whenever there is a magnetic field and there is a soft iron, so if you keep any magnetic field and a soft iron, they are going to get attracted. So this soft iron is going to get attracted. So it is going to have some movement because we are going to fix it to spindle. So because of this, we are going to produce a deflection torque, and based on this, the spindle is going to get move. Then now there is a controlling torque. The controlling torque is because of the spring's movement. And then we can say here, so now the TD, deflection torque, is produced because of the electromagnet and also soft iron disc. And controlling torque is because of the spring control. And also the damping torque, we are going to reduce the oscillations and steady state with the help of air damping. So permalloy is nothing but this core is made of permalloy. Permalloy is a combination of nickel and iron. Nickel has a percentage of 80% and iron of very low percentage, which is 20%. So if you combine these two things, we say it is a permalloy. So basically, we are going to make this core with the help of permalloy to increase the sensitivity. Increasing the sensitivity is nothing but if the voltage is very small, even if the voltage is very small, it is going to produce a small amount of current. This small amount of current is enough to produce a magnetic field through this core. Then the soft iron disc, this is going to move with the help of this magnetic field. So we can say sensitivity is nothing but how much amount of small voltage it can be sensed by this soft iron disc, so therefore the pointer can move. So the sensitivity, even a small amount of voltage, can be sensed by this pointer whenever we make a core of permalloy, which is nothing but is a combination of nickel and iron. So nickel is a percentage of 80% and iron of 20%. So basically, sensitivity is nothing but how much amount of small voltage you can measure with the help of this MI instrument, so therefore the pointer can move. It can indicate that voltage if you make a permalloy, say if you make the core with the help of permalloy. And also we have know that deflection torque equation in a MI instrument is half I square dl by d theta, and the controlling torque is a spring control, which is kc into theta. At a steady state, whatever the deflection torque should be equal to controlling torque, then only the pointer is going to be at a steady state condition. So if you do this one, finally we are going to get theta is directly proportional to square of current. It is a non-linear equation, so therefore whatever the scale you are going to get, it is a non-linear scale, or we can say cramped scale. So initial divisions are very close to each other, and if you move forward, the divisions are have a very huge amount of gap. So we can say the distance between the divisions is non-linear. So because of this reason, we say it is a non-linear scale or cramped scale. Suppose if you want to reduce the temperature errors, then we have to make these windings with the help of magnet. So because the magnet is a constant temperature device, means even the temperature is going to vary, its resistance is independent of temperature. So we can say if you make the coil with the help of magnet, the temperature errors can be reduced. So temperature errors can be reduced by using magnet for resistance because they have a constant temperature coefficient devices. And also, suppose if you want to remove the stray fields errors. Stray fields error means, suppose if you are going to keep an external magnetic field, this external magnetic field can enter inside this measuring instrument and it can alter the internal magnetic field. So therefore, the pointer can, so we can, with the help of external magnetic field, we can control the pointer movement. So if you don't want to do that, if you want to remove the stray magnetic field errors, then you have to cover this measuring instrument in an iron shield. So if you cover this measuring instrument in an iron shield, or we can even say iron case or iron shield. So because iron is a pure conductor, so therefore no external magnetic field can enter into this conductor. So therefore we can say, as the external magnetic field is not going to enter inside this, or we can say the external magnetic field is not going to enter inside, so therefore internal magnetic field is not altered by the external magnetic field. So we can simply say that stray magnetic fields errors can be reduced if you make, if you cover this measuring instrument by an iron case or iron shield. So stray magnetic field errors can be decreased by using iron case or iron shield. So now I've already told you, suppose if you want to increase the sensitivity, then you have to make this core with the help of permalloy. And if you want to reduce the temperature errors, then you have to make this material, this coil, with the help of magnet. And if you want to remove the stray magnetic field errors, then definitely you have to keep, or you can cover this measuring instrument with the help of iron case or iron shield. It's a pure conductor, so magnetic fields cannot enter inside a pure conductor. So because of these reasons, the external magnetic field is not going to alter the internal magnetic field. So now we are going to solve the 25th question. See the question here. A conductor of length 100 cm moves right angles to a magnetic field of flux density of 2 Weber per meter square. So with a velocity of 25 meter per second, the induced EMF in the conductor will be. So basically here they are given a conductor of some certain length, and also this conductor is going to move in a direction which is perpendicular to the magnetic field. So now what is the EMF which is going to induced in this conductor, we need to figure out. So what are the four options? Option B, 50 volt is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. So here in this question they are given a magnetic field which is perpendicular to the motion of the conductor. So let me assume the conductor is the length of L, the conductor having length of L, and it is moving in such a direction which is perpendicular to the magnetic field. So if you see carefully, this is in the x direction and this is the minus y direction. So we can say both are perpendicular to each other. So now the length of the conductor is 100 cm. So I am going to convert in terms of meters. I am going to get 100 into 10 to the power of minus 2 meter, and the magnetic field density which is 2 Weber per meter square, and also the velocity which the conductor is going to move, which is 25 meter per second. So now based on this, we have to find what is the amount of EMF which is going to induce in the conductor, we need to figure out. So basic expression is E bar is equal to L of V bar cross V bar, but I want to know only the magnitude value. So therefore magnitude of E bar is equal to L into VB sine theta. So theta is the angle between the V and V bar. So V bar and B bar. So V bar in this direction and B bar in this direction. So angle between them is 90 degree. This is the V bar and this is the B bar. So angle between them is 90 degree. So therefore theta is equal to 90 degree. So substitute here, L is equal to 100 into 10 to the power of minus 2, and V is 25 meter per second, and V is 2 and sine of 90. So if you solve this one, we are going to get 50 volt. So 50 volts is going to induced in this length of connector if you are going to move this connector in a direction which is perpendicular to the magnetic field. So now we are going to solve the 26th question. See the question here. Which of the following circuit will have no transients? Option A, pure resistive circuit. Option B, LC circuit. Option C, RLC circuit. And option D, RL circuit. So out of the four options, option A, resistive, pure resistive circuit will never have a transients. And option A is the correct solution of this question. So let's discuss something more about this one. In basic electrical engineering, the three basic passive elements are resistor, inductor and capacitor. So here the inductor is basically an energy storing element. So we can say it cannot accept or be. So here for an inductor, the current cannot change instantaneously. So for inductor, current cannot change instantaneously. Whereas for a capacitor, voltage cannot change instantaneously. So therefore, inductor will always oppose the rate of change of current and capacitor will always oppose the rate of change of voltage. So because of these things, we can say if any circuit contains the energy storing elements, then the transients are going to definitely occur, because the current cannot change instantaneously for an inductor and the voltage cannot change instantaneously for a capacitor. So because of these things, the transients are going to occur for inductor and capacitor. So if any circuit contains the energy storing elements, then definitely there will be transients. For a resistor, the voltage and current can change at any time. They can change at instantaneously. So because of this thing, we can say for resistor there will be no transients. So if a circuit has pure resistive, there will be no transients. And if any circuit contains the resistor, if any circuit contains an inductor or capacitor, if they contains both, then definitely the circuit will definitely have a transients, because these are the energy storing elements, and also they cannot accept the sudden change in current or sudden change in voltage. So because of these things, we can say that transients are going to occur in a circuit even if these two elements are there, or even if one of them is present. But for a pure resistive circuit, there is no transients, because the current and voltage can change at any time. So because of this reason, we can say for a pure resistive circuit, there will be no transient are going to occur. So now we are going to solve the 27th question. See the question here. The starting torque of a three-phase induction motor can be increased by. So the starting torque of a three-phase induction motor, so we can increase by which one? So out of the four options, option B, increasing the rotor resistance. So if you increase the rotor resistance, then compulsory the starting torque of a three-phase induction motor is going to get increased. And now we'll discuss something more about this one. So option B is the correct solution of this question. So here For a three-phase induction motor, the electrical torque which is generated is 180 by 2 pi ns into s into Vd square R2 by R2 square plus s X2 whole square, where R2 is called as a rotor resistance and X2 is called as a rotor reactance. So the starting torque is directly proportional to rotor resistance. So torque is always proportional to rotor resistance. So we can say if you want to increase the starting torque, then definitely the rotor resistance must be increased. So whenever the rotor resistance increases, the starting torque is also going to increase. So now how we can increase the rotor resistance? See, rotor resistance can be either increased internally or whether we can add externally. So increasing internal rotor resistance means for a squirrel cage induction motor, you can replace the squirrel cage induction rotor bars with the help of, you can replace copper by aluminium. So aluminium has huge amount of resistance when compared to copper. So because of this, the starting torque is going to increase. And also increasing external rotor resistance. So we cannot add external rotor resistance for a squirrel cage induction motor, but we can add for a slip ring induction motor. So because of these reasons, so the first method is useful for a squirrel cage induction motor and the second one is used for the slip ring induction motor. So because of this, we can say that if you want to increase the starting torque, then definitely you have to increase the rotor resistance. So for a squirrel cage induction motor, you have to replace the bars with the help of huge amount of resistance, and for a slip ring induction motor you have to add externally rotor resistance. So because of this, the starting torque can be increased. And there is also another method by which we can increase the starting resistance, or we can say the starting torque can be increased by even other method, which is V by F control. So V by F is nothing but here voltage by frequency should be constant. Suppose if you are increasing voltage, then you have to increase the frequency also, then its ratio should be equal to constant, then also we can improve the starting torque. See here, suppose this is the graph for frequency 1 and this is the graph for frequency 2 and this is the graph for frequency 3. So if you see carefully, the synchronous speed is equal to 120 f by p. As if you are increasing the frequency, as the frequency increases, the synchronous speed is also going to increase. So we can say f3 here, ns3 is greater than ns2 is greater than ns1. So simply we can say as f3 is more, the synchronous speed also equal to more. So as f3 is greater than f2 greater than f1, so we can say ns3 greater than ns2 greater than ns1. As the frequency is going to increase, the starting torque is going to get decrease, and also the maximum torque is constant for each and every frequency. So for a V by F is equal to constant, so if for a V by F is equal to constant, also we can produce the maximum torque constant. And if the frequency decreases, means the starting torque goes on decreases. But if you reduce the frequency and reduce the voltage, then we can compulsory say that the starting torque is also going to increase. But there is a one disadvantage, which is the synchronous speed is also going to decrease. As the synchronous speed is going to decrease, the rotor is going to rotate in a very slow manner, with very slow speed. Even the starting torque is very high, but it is going to rotate with a lesser speed. That is a disadvantage. So we can say that we can improve the starting torque with the help of increasing the rotor resistance, or we can reduce the frequency and also reduce the voltage. Even then also we can increase the starting torque, but one disadvantage is it can rotate with very low speed because the synchronous speed is also going to decrease. So these are the things that you have to remember. So now we are going to solve the 20th question. See the question here. The capacitor short capacitor run single phase induction motor is operationally A. So here in this question they are given capacitor start, capacitor run, induction motor is operationally what type of motor? So out of the four options, option B, two phase motor is the correct solution of this question. So let's discuss something more about this one. So now we'll discuss something about the capacitor start, capacitor run, single phase induction motor. So now we are going to give a single phase supply, and here in the stator we are going to use the two windings, which are the main winding and the auxiliary winding. So in the stator we are going to use the two windings, which are the main winding and the auxiliary winding, and they are going to placed in such a way which are the 90 degree perpendicular. So these two coils are going to make in a such a direction, they are going to wound in a stator in such a direction which are 90 degree angle between them. And also here the rotor is in this shape, it's a rotor, it's a cage rotor. So on this we are going to use the armature winding, and now here it is a running capacitor. CR is the running capacitor and CS is the starting capacitor, and this is a switch. Suppose if you want to operate this one, the first thing is you have to close the switch. you have to close the switch. Then here CS is called as the starting capacitor and CR is called as the running capacitor. So CS, the starting capacitor, is made with the help of electrolytic capacitor. It is basically a electrolytic capacitor, whereas the running capacitor is a oil filled paper capacitor. So CS is nothing but the starting capacitor, which is made of electrolytic capacitor, whereas the running capacitor is made of oil filled paper capacitor. So if you want to basically run this rotor, then initially you have to close the switch. Then at starting, these two capacitors are in parallel to each other, so therefore then it is going to pick up some speed, and after gaining some speed, then you have to remove this one. So that is the reason we say it is a capacitor start, means we are going to use the capacitor start, the CS, at the initial by closing the switch. After gaining certain speed, we are going to remove the switch, means we don't want the CS. So therefore now we are going to use only the CR. So at initially we are going to use both the CR and CS, but after some time, after the rotor is going to gain some speed, we are going to use only the CR but not CS with the help of removing the switch. So now here we are going to use the two windings, which are the main winding and auxiliary winding. So because of these two windings, we are going to get two fluxes. Because of these two fluxes interaction, we are going to get a rotating magnetic field. So because of this rotating magnetic field, this rotor is going to get rotated. So because of these two windings, we are going to say it is a two-phase motor. So this is the reason we are going to call this as a two-phase motor. Even the supply is a single phase, because we are using the two windings. So because of these two windings, we are going to get a rotating field. Then with the help of this rotating field, the rotor is going to get rotated. So because of this, we say it is a two-phase motor. Because of two phases, we are going to get a rotating magnetic field. So because of that, we say it is a two-phase motor. At initial condition, for starting of the operation of rotor, we are going to use a CS, but after gaining some speed, we are going to open the switch, then only CR is there in order to rotate this one. So we can say it is a very quiet and easy operation. So it is always a quiet and smooth running. So the noise of this motor is very much less, and it's a very quiet. So we can say smooth running and very quiet. And these are the important things of this capacitor start, capacitor run, single phase induction motor. Even the supply is a single phase, because of these two windings, we are going to say it is a two phase motor. Because of these two windings are going to produce a flux, because of the interaction of these fluxes, that overall rotating magnetic field is going to get produced. So we say it is a two phase motor. So now we are going to solve the 29th question. See the question here. Equalizer rings in DC generator with lap windings are used for. So equalizer rings are used in DC generator for lap winding. So why we are going to use this one? So what are the four options? Option A, equal distribution of current at brushes for sparkless commutation. So option A is the correct solution of this question. So let's discuss why the equalizer rings are used in the DC generator for the lap winding, about the solution in a very detailed manner. So now for a DC generator, if you are going to use armature winding in terms of lap winding, so we are going to wound the armature winding in terms of lap winding. Then here for lap winding, the number of parallel paths is equal to number of poles, and also the number of brushes. So the number of brushes is equal to number of parallel paths is equal to number of poles for a lap winding. So therefore we can say for lap winding, as the number of parallel paths are going to increase, so therefore it will have a huge amount of current. So current rating will increase, but the voltage rating is going to get decrease. As the number of parallel paths are going to increase, so therefore the current capacity, means it is used for only high current rating but low voltage. So this is a low voltage and high rating, high current machine. So now here what is going to happen is, suppose I am going to take a machine of four poles. 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four poles. Ideally, the flux produced by each pole is same. So you suppose the north pole is going to produce a flux of 5. So therefore, south pole, north pole, all are going to produce the same amount of flux, ideally. So therefore, now, as the number of poles are 4, so therefore the number of parallel paths are equal to 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And also the number of brushes is 4. 1, 2, 3 and 4. As the flux is same for each and every pole, so therefore the amount of induced EMF and the amount of current induced in the armature winding is same for each and every conductor, armature conductor. So because of this, if you see carefully, if this current is I and this current is I and here also the current is I and here also the current is I, so I plus I is 2I, so therefore here also 2I, and here the current is 4I, and here also the current is 2I, and here also the current is 2i. So therefore here the current is 2i. And let me assume this is the positive terminal and this is the negative terminal. So because of this, each and every brush is going to load same manner, because the current in this brush is 2i and here also the current in the brush is 2i. So each and every brush is going to load it in a equal manner. But practically what is going to happen? But practically, suppose these two poles, these two north pole and south pole are going to have a flux of pi 1, but north pole and south pole here, they are going to have a flux of phi 2. But practically one of them is going to be higher than the remaining one. This is a practical case. So let me assume flux phi 1 is greater than flux phi 2. So because of this, what is going to happen is the connectors, the armature connectors across this north and south are going to have huge amount of current and huge amount of EMF, whereas the armature connectors across this north and south pole will have less flux, so less induced EMF and less induced current. So therefore, let me assume these two connectors are across the north and south pole, so they are going to have flux of phi 1. So therefore, induced voltage is E1 and the current is I1. These two connectors are going to present in here, north and south, so therefore the flux is lesser, so amount of induced EMF is also lesser, which is E2 and I2. So here I am going to assume I1 is greater than I2 and also E1 is greater than E2. So because of this one, the overall current here is 2I1 and overall current is 2I2, and here the overall current is 2I1 and here the overall current is 2I2. So if you see carefully here, these two brushes are having huge amount of current and these two brushes are having lower amount of current. So we can say that here the brushes are not loaded in an equal manner. So these two brushes are loaded in a huge manner and these two brushes are loaded in a less manner. So because of this unloading, or we can say difference of loading of the brushes, we can say here this is a commutator and this is a commutator. Then what is going to happen at commutation process? Because of this commutator, the amount of current should be reversed, but at commutation the current cannot be reversed in an equal manner at each and every brush. So because of this reason, we can say a spark is going to occur between a commutator and a brush, because this all the brushes are loaded in an unequal manner, so the current cannot be reversed in same at each and every where. So we can say that a spark is going to produce that commutator and a brush. But now what is going to happen? So now what I am going to do is I am going to connect an equalizer ring. So equalizer ring is nothing but it is basically a low resistance copper connectors. These are nothing but a made by copper connectors which has a low amount of resistance. So now this equalizer rings are going to connect across a potential difference. If there is any, we are going to connect across this. Suppose this is the equalizer ring. If there is any potential difference between these two coils, we are going to connect across them. So because of this potential difference, this is E1 and this is E2, because there is a potential difference. So because of this potential difference, a current is going to get flow. A current is going to get flow through this one. So now, because of this current is going to flow, so now this will become huge, same current as the previous one. So now here, because of this one, the current will be as the previous one. So now everything is current I. So if you can compare here, now each one is going to be loaded in a same manner. 2i. So now if you connect an equalizer ring across a potential difference, a current is going to get flow, which is called a circulating current is going to get flow. And now because of this reason, the brushes are going to get loaded in an equal manner. Inside it may be I1 and I2, but outside the current is I now. I1, I1 and here I2, I2. Even inside it may be same, but outside the brushes are going to have same amount of current, which is 2i. This is called as a circulating current. So now we can say that the brushes are loaded in an equal manner, so with the help of equalizer rings. So now we can say the brushes are, means we can share in the current in an equal manner for each and every brush. So we can say there is no spark. Now a spark cannot occur at commutation, because now current can change at each and every brushes. So therefore there is no spark is going to occur between the brush and a commutator if you use a equalizer ring between a two non-zero potentials, or we can say different potentials. If you keep a connector, a circulating connector across two different voltages, a circulating current is going to get flow. So then the overall brushes are going to have same phase, same amount of current, which as the previous one. So equal sharing of current at brushes. So because of this, the current can change its direction at commutation process. So therefore no spark is going to occur between a commutator and a brush at commutation process. So finally, I am going to conclude that equalizer rings are going to use in a DC generator for lap winding in order to share the current equally. So therefore, there is no spark between a commutator and a brush. So now we are going to solve the last question of this lecture. See the question here. The Buchholz relay is normally used to protect the. So the Buchholz relay is normally used to protect the. Out of all these options, option B, oil immersed transformer against all internal faults. So we are going to use this Buchholz relay in order to protect the transformer against all internal faults. Now we'll discuss something more about this one. So basically it is a transformer and this is a Buchholz relay and this is a conservator. These are going to cut in this fashion. So now here transformer is going to immerse in an oil. So we are going to use the oil in order to immerse this transformer because oil is used for two purposes, which is cooling purpose and also for insulation purpose. So it is going to radiate the heat from the transformer and also it can insulate the windings. So these two things can be used with the help of oil. So now this Buchholz relay is nothing but it is a gas and oil activated relay. Suppose some internal fault is occurring in a transformer. Then because of internal fault, the heating is going to get produced. As the oil is going to get heated, then gas bubbles are going to get generated. And these gas bubbles are going to go through this Buchholz relay and there is an alarm here. So this alarm is going to sense the gas. So because of this sensing gas, it is going to give an alarm that something internal fault has been occurred. So with the help of this one, we can say it is basically an oil and gas activated relay. So as the heat is going to get, whenever there is a fault, a heat is going to get produced. As there is a oil and also there is a heat, so oil is going to get heat, which is a nothing but a gas is going to get generated. This gas is going to get sensed by this Buchholz relay and it is going to give an alarm that something fault has been occurred in a transformer. So therefore we can say it is going to protect the transformer from all internal faults. So it is nothing but it is going to protect the transformer from all internal faults. And here we are going to use this Buchholz relay. We are going to use this Buchholz relay only for those transformers which have a rating of greater than 500 kVA. So only for those transformers which have a rating of greater than 500 kVA, only for these transformers we are going to use this Buchholz relay. It is basically a oil gas activated relay and it is going to sense the gas and it is going to give an alarm that something fault is going to occur in this transformer. So now we can repair whatever the things a fault is occurred. So by this lecture we have successfully completed the 30 questions of the previous year of the ISRO 2017 W solutions in a very detailed manner. And if you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel and don't forget to press the bell icon button so whenever we upload a new video the direct notifications comes from mobile. If any improvements needed in our lectures, then please do comment in the comment section. We will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. Thank you so much for watching this lecture. Keep smiling, take care and bye bye.